a Go Ordnance team. So right now what we're going to be doing, we're going to be talking about an AC system. So right now in front of me, I have Sergeant Myers. He's a 91 Bravo. We were just talking, and it sounds like he's ASC certified. So what's your ASC certification that you already have?
The ASC certification I have, Sergeant Major, is the MIL-1 certification that is offered through the military here.
Wow. Sergeant Palafox, go ahead. Tell me a little bit about yourself.
I've been in the Army for 8 years, Sergeant Major. And I am certified MIL-1, also 609, EPA 609 certified.
Wow, 609 certified. What does 609 certification mean to you, Private Flood?
I have no idea.
You have no idea.
I'm assuming it's something to do with working on vehicles.
Working on vehicles. You got it. You got to help us out. So you just talked about a certification. You just came up to me running saying, hey, Sergeant Major, we've got an AC problem. What does that mean, and what are we talking about when you talked about that certification?
Yes, Sergeant Major. So it's the Environmental Protection Agency certification. It covers automotive refrigerants and also covers home certifications. But the one for homes is EPA 608. The one we're talking about today is 609, which is going to be covering all the vehicles that we work on in the military and civilian side.
Wow, that's pretty powerful. So it really sounds like just because you're inside the military as a 91 series, that it really translates into the civilian sector as well as the military. It's about the basic fundamentals. So I just heard that you're both ASC certified. Private Flood and I just learned a whole bunch about the certification process. And so I see that we have a vehicle right behind us. So what are we going to be talking about today? Can you walk us through the problem that we're having?
Yes, Sergeant Major. So we have an issue with the system not blowing cold air. So the AC system, we have to troubleshoot to verify if there's enough refrigerant inside the system.
Okay, I see a Robin air machine, but we also know that not everybody has a Robin air machine.
Correct.
Is there some type of gauges or something that we can use to check this out?
Correct, Sergeant Major. Today we're going to be doing it as if you were in your home, charging yourself and verifying that the system has the proper and adequate amount of refrigerant pressure inside it.
Okay, sounds good. So Private Flood. So one, how long have you been in school?
About 2 weeks now.
2 weeks. So this is all new. You came from basic training where?
Fort Jackson.
Did you love it?
Oh, I loved it. It was great.
Absolutely great. Yeah. Are you glad to be here at Fort Gregg Adams?
Happy to be here. Yes.
Yeah. So I know you're excited. You're a future 91 Bravo. And then you're also what we call AMOD. But what is AMOD? I don't understand that. So Private Flood, could you explain a little bit about what that first mod that you're learning?
We're learning all about safety, the different tools that we'll be using. It's basically getting us ready for everything that we're gonna be covering.
Wow. So it sounds like we're about to deep dive in some tools right here when we talk about the AC system. So this is a good foundation to be able to learn from, correct?
Yes, sir.
So I had an opportunity to talk to you, and you talked about utilizing items like YouTube to be able to then troubleshoot. You talked a little bit about your car. I heard that you do drive a Ram truck. So do I. So we're not impartial to any type of vehicle out there, but what kind of issues were you having with your AC system that made you have to go to YouTube?
It wasn't blowing cold air, it was blowing hot air.
Well, that's good, because we're about to teach you how to troubleshoot and how to fix your vehicle as long as you're properly certified, which you will be becoming part of the Ordnance Corps. So without further ado, why don't we go ahead and take a look at this vehicle, and you can walk us through the gauges and then also what's happening to the vehicle.
So Private Flood, do you see that red cap right there?
Right here.
That is your high side. That is a unique fitting. The only fitting that will fit is these R134 alpha gauges. If you're working with a different type of refrigerant, these gauges will not work. The blue cap, that shows you that's your low side, also known as your suction. Okay, so first thing we're going to do, we're going to take off those two caps and set them aside. Do not lose them. That keeps the unique fittings clean and free of debris. Okay, so corresponding colors. The one on the right was the high side, right? High side, think about it, is dangerous. Red is dangerous, right? So go ahead. The way you're going to hook them up, you're going to first verify that these gauges are all the way closed. If you see here, this way is open. You're actually pushing in a little valve inside.
Okay.
So make sure it's all the way closed. You're good. So whenever you hook it up, you're gonna pull back on this. It's a quick disconnect, just like an air compressor.
Okay.
So go ahead and hook up the big one. It should only fit on one. The high side has one fitting and the low side has another fitting, okay? So hook up the low side. Now that we verify that they're both good, before we open up the system, think of it that way. You open up the system, you're gonna thread them in, you're gonna allow the system to release the refrigerant into these lines.
Okay.
Before we do that, we wanna make sure our gauges are all the way closed. Same thing, we have to open them out, right? The moment we start screwing them in, that's closing the system.
Okay.
So verify that both gauges are all the way out. Okay, so both systems are closed. Now we are good to actually close the system on those lines over there. Remember, you're gonna screw them in to the right. It's like tightening up a soda bottle.
Screw them all the way?
Yes. You're gonna watch your gauges over here. They moved, right? They're both at zero before. You always wanna verify that these gauges are at zero before allowing refrigerant into the lines. So, now we see the gauges. What numbers do you read on the low side?
I got about 70 on the low.
About 70? What do you have on the high side?
About 90.
Okay, so 50 would be right here, 100 right here. What's in between 100 and 50?
75.
Okay, so about 70, 75, right? So what we're looking at here is to make sure that they're both equal. Whenever the system's been off for about an hour or two, both the high side and the low side will equal out.
Okay.
If they do not equal out, let's say on this side you had 100 PSI, PSIG, and then on this side you had 20. Then it's telling you that there's some sort of clog in the high side.
Okay.
Now, if we had the opposite, and then this side was higher than the high side, then we know we have a clog somewhere on the low pressure side.
Okay.
When we go look at the chart, you'll better understand what I mean about the two different sides. So, let's annotate what we got here. We got about 70 equaled out, okay? Now we're gonna move on to the actual chart. Right now, we still don't know if the system has a low refrigerant in it. But looking at the chart that anybody could Google on any sort of .org website, it will give you a chart that tells you exactly how it works. Preferably the EPA chart, which we have pulled up on the TV screen. So, first we need to figure out, what was the number that we got in those gauges?
70 all the way across.
Okay, so we got 70, right? So, Sergeant Major Decker, do you know what the temperature is inside this bay right now?
Well, what's the temperature of this bay?
75.
About 75 degrees.
75, okay. So here we have the chart we were talking about not too long ago. Private flood. What should the pressure be at 75 degrees?
About 78.7.
78.7, and what was our reading back at the truck?
70.
So that tells us that we have low refrigerant pressure inside our truck. Can that be the reason why it's not blowing cold? Private flood?
It could be.
Do you know why?
Because there's not enough pressure in it.
Yes, but there's a safety mechanism in our compressor down here. So our compressor actually has a safety feature for the high, if it has too much high pressure or if it has too low of a pressure. If the pressure is too low, it won't sense to kick on and actually engage the clutch. So if you see here, private flood, this spins freely, right?
Yes.
Okay. So this mechanism right here on the inside, this is what actually spins the pump.
Okay.
This pumps and builds pressure inside the AC system. So when it's freely spinning like this, it's not doing anything for us. What we need it to do, we need to send signal from the low pressure switch to engage the clutch. Once the clutch engages, then when they spin together, create that pressure. See how that works?
Yep.
So right now, we have low pressure, pretty much have to charge more pressure into it. But before we move into that, we are gonna go into the AC flow chart. That way we could all understand the difference between the high side and the low side, like I explained to you back at the truck. So, prior flood, what we just had in our hand was the compressor, right?
Yep.
Builds up pressure, builds up high pressure. So it goes from number one and it works its way down to number two. Can you tell me what number two is?
That's a condenser in the
fan. Okay, so today we actually have a condenser right in front of us right here. if you could show the rest of our audience. So that is your condenser. A lot of people might confuse this for your radiator. It is not your radiator. An easy way to verify is to just look at the thickness on the side. A radiator will be a lot thicker and you will have coolant running through instead of refrigerant. And then from there, we move on to our filter dryer, number three. You know what the purpose of a filter dryer is?
To filter out anything that would be in the lines.
Yes, any contaminants. It also filters non-condensable gases, which could be like water, pretty much just water. So once you get it from there, it dries and filters out any media that's not necessary in the AC system. From there, we're done with the filter. We go to this little magical thing right here. That is number four. Can you tell me what number four is?
Number four would be the expansion valve.
Does anybody know what the expansion valve does?
I don't.
Okay, I will explain. So it actually has two jobs. It turns high pressure. Right here, as we see in yellow, this is still high pressure, and it converts into low pressure liquid. So whenever it goes to low pressure, it goes into our evaporator. Evaporator is what actually sucks the heat out of the vehicle and turns it and blows it into cold air. But from here, the expansion valve has another job. Now it has to turn in that low pressure gas back into
the expansion valve,
and then from there it goes to the compressor again. So it's just like a circle of life, just keeps going. It's a closed system. It's not like your engine oil where it gets burned off. You should never have to refill this unless you have a leak. So that is pretty much it for how the system works. So remember how I told you if you have a higher pressure on one side versus the other? This is what would be determined the high side on this side of the expansion valve. This side over here, this would be your low pressure.
Okay.
So if the low side would have had a higher pressure than the high side, you know there's a problem somewhere in this area.
And that could be a clog.
It could be a clog from the debris, or the expansion valve might be messed up. Evaporator core might not be working properly. Or your blower might even be bad.
Okay.
And same thing with the high pressure side. Your filter dryer could be clogged from filtering too much debris, or your condenser can also be clogged up.
Which part's the most common to go faulty before?
So the most common things on the low side would be your expansion valve, because that has very small orifices, and your condenser as well. What do you think is the number one thing on this chart that gets least damaged?
I would say...
It is also the most expensive component of the system.
The compressor.
Perfect. A lot of shops, they'll try to get that money out of you, right? So they'll actually say, oh, it's the compressor. It's almost never the compressor. About 90% of the time, the compressor will not be a problem. So. The only thing that can go bad on the compressor, really, is that clutch. The clutch does wear out after time.
Is that something that can be rebuildable, or is it easier just to replace it?
So you can replace that clutch itself, maybe like $70 versus the whole compressor being $800.
Wow.
So we're done with the chart. Now we can work our way back to actually charging it.
Okay,
Prior Flood. So now we're actually gonna charge the system, okay?
Okay.
We're gonna use R134 Alpha. And we know this vehicle, we looked at the actual label, verified that that's what it uses, used the technical manual to verify as well. And like I said before, these gauges, they're only gonna work for R134 Alpha.
Okay.
Where do you think you could get this from?
Really any parts store.
Exactly. So one thing that you do have to be before you actually work on the system, you gotta be 609 certified. Here at the schoolhouse, we will provide that for you. You will test out, you'll be certified, and then you'll get to work on this.
Okay.
So I'm gonna walk you through it. We're not actually gonna be doing the charging, but I'm gonna walk you through how to do it. So first we wanna be able to get the contents from here into the truck. We're only gonna fill on the low side. never on the high side because then you're creating a bomb.
Okay.
So the way we could prevent that is we're only gonna use the low side. We're gonna close the low side and open up the valve that lets refrigerant flow into the system. Remember how that those gauges over there allow these gauges to work, but now we're adding to the actual system itself.
Right.
So the way we would do it, we would just hook it up right here. It would puncture the hole in there, and now this is connected to this yellow line.
Okay. Do you have to hold it any type of way?
Yes.
Down,
so it actually has directions on the back. It tells you to rotate it on its side, and then you're pretty much swishing it in there. It's okay. Liquid inside there. If you hold it up straight up, all the liquid is just going to go straight down anyway. So that would work optimally. Now that we have it hooked up, we would open up this valve. We're not going to open it up right now because it would let refrigerant back in here since we don't have anything in this container. With the truck running, we'd be able to fill on the low side. If you had Robinair, the Robinair would do everything for you. But this is for us to be able to do it at home.
Okay.
For our family members.
Does it have to be running while you have the Robinair?
So with the Robinair, we do it with the truck off.
Okay.
But with this, you need to be able to create that suction. Remember, the blue side is the suction line. So it's gonna suck the contents from this container into the system, and then push it in through the whole system, go into the high side, and work its way up. We're gonna be watching the gauges. The gauges will be fluctuating. The high side will get progressively higher, up to 200, 250. The low side, you want it to keep it between, you want the highest portion to go up to 70, okay, right? At the most, depending on the ambient temperature. Whenever the clutch kicks on, the gauges will go down. You never want it to go below 20. If it goes below 20, it means you do not have enough refrigerant. So once you got it within those tolerances that we talked about on the chart, then we know the system is good and you should be able to fill cold air inside the cab. You can also use the thermostat, put in your vent, and it'll tell you that it's blowing 60 degrees or 55, depending on what you want to blow.
Okay.
Just be careful not to overfill the system.
What happens if you overfill the system?
You'll hit the high pressure solenoid or sensor, and it won't work. You'll have the same problem all over again. You'll get blowing hot air.
Okay.
That's for your own safety, because you'll be creating a bomb,
right,
if you put too much in there. And that's pretty much all it takes to refill your system with our 134 Alpha.
Hey team, as you can see, what we just did is we recharged an AC system because of the fact that we found out that it was low. Private Flood over here, not only was he taught how to do it, but I believe you're confident to be able to work on your RAM where you probably don't need to use YouTube anymore, right?
Absolutely.
All right, so you learned. And then you went through all the components. We went through what the system actually does and how it operates. We also looked at a couple charts that are probably important because without those charts, it's hard to really gauge to know exactly how much to put inside there. Is that correct?
Yes, Sergeant Major.
Sergeant Myers. So I think it's important, we started this by talking about getting certified in credentials, and we also learned that it is important for us to make sure that we're certified to do and to work on an AC system. And let's just review a little bit of why is that so important for us to make sure that we're certified to be able to do that and follow the EPA guidelines.
So Sergeant Major, the reason that's important is because it's actually the federal law. If you are doing any type of AC work without being 609 certified, you could be fined up to $50,000 per day per violation. And there's also people that can actually whistleblower against you to get up to $10,000 just by turning you in. And so that's just a fund that I can't afford. So I know none of these soldiers can afford it either, Sergeant Major. So that's why we here at FMODN at the schoolhouse, we teach the rules and regulations so that all these soldiers can become EPA 609 certified, and it's a lifetime certification. Then they can go out, they can repair their vehicles, they can repair anyone else's vehicles, and as long as they just continue to do the right thing, Sergeant Major, they're not gonna have any issues at all.
Well, that's pretty powerful. So you're saying that not only for the military side, that certification is something that the civilian side uses also?
Correct, Sergeant Major. They do have to go through the same training we do here, and they also will be certified on 609. Every shop will have records of them, so no one can claim that they are not certified when they will have that lifetime certification on them.
So as you can see, the students that are right behind us, not only do we teach military, but we also translate this to the civilian sector too. So come on, join our team. I will tell you, this is a great environment to be part of. And like always, keep it under the hood.
Go Ordnance!